Welcome to the 15th session in the Worlds of Speculative Fiction, the third this year in this monthly series, where we look at classic and some contemporary science fiction, fantasy, and this year we'll even look at some horror works and authors, and we look a bit at the world building, although there's not a lot of that in Douglas Adams, quite frankly. And we talk a lot about philosophical themes in the literature. There are a lot in Douglas Adams, so that's going to be a lot of fun. I know most of you, those of you who don't know me, I'm Greg Sadler. I'm a, you could say, local philosopher. I used to teach full-time. Now I do a lot of other things, including, you know, quite a bit of public speaking. So what we do in these talks, you know, I do some lecturing, but we usually have a lot of discussion. Anybody can ask questions at any time. I give you a few handouts and some quotations from the person to give some context. So what we usually do is we begin... Come on in.
Checkers?
Yes.
Yeah. We begin with, you know, some just a few starting remarks. We go over the biography of the person a little bit just to get some context. And then we jump into the world building and the philosophical themes. So with Adams, we've got somebody who unfortunately died pretty young. Go ahead and have a seat.
I am saving this.
Oh, is it?
We'll slide down. He's getting
yeah,
another chair.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we you know,
friendlier and friendlier.
Yeah. We cozier,
we need a bigger
right?
room.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to go back to our interview.
So
are you sure?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We got another chair coming. He's getting one.
All right. So I first started reading Adams I think in high school, and you know Hitchhiker's Guide had come out and I saw the TV show and I thought that was kind of interesting.
Here.
Yeah.
We have extras.
Here. And so. You know, it was kind of a popular thing to read in high school and in college, and I don't think I got half of the jokes that are built into it because I didn't know enough myself to get them. But the kids who are smarter than me certainly seem to be into it. Adams himself has a lot of interesting things to say, and some of them are here on the remarks. I wanted to start out by actually talking about the origin of this. He talks about that in this, you know, omnibus version that we have of the novels, but he also talks about it in this interview from 79. And the origin of it is really kind of extraordinary. He didn't set out to write a book. He set out to do a radio show. And he said, I'd given up on the idea of science fiction comedy because no one was interested. And he says that he would go to the you know the comedy people and suggest sci-fi stuff and they'd be like, that's drama, go over there. And so he tried and they'd be like, no, what you want is comedy, go over there. So he's going back and forth and never getting a good answer. So then this guy Simon Brett suggested the idea, I'd like to do a sci-fi comedy and I think you might be the guy to do it. So I sort of fell out of my chair. It was a couple of days after that the title came. I had quite a lot of separate plots in my mind, each of which involved the end of the world. So we thought we were going to do six independent half-hour stories, each ending with the end of the world. Which sounds like a cool premise, right? It was going to be called The Ends of the Earth. And then suddenly I remembered what had struck me 6 years previously, but I hadn't done anything about it. Hadn't even remembered in the intervening time, which is when I'd been hitchhiking around Europe when I was a student or just before I went up to Cambridge. I had this book called The Hitchhiker's Guide to Europe, and I think some of, you know, we may remember other hitchhiker's guides like this, right? And I remember wandering into a campsite in Innsbruck late one night, not entirely sober, the stars were all out, and I remember thinking at the time, he actually talks about this in other cases, he's laying on his back looking at the sky, somebody ought to write A Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And then he just left that idea kind of fermenting in the back of his head, like, you know, piece of cheese or something for years until he finally had the chance to do something with it, and that becomes The Hitchhiker's Guide, which starts out originally as a radio show for the BBC, not as a book, but it's fairly simple to turn, you know, that sort of thing into a book. You just have to, you know, add narrative to it, and that's what he did. Adams was not a particularly prolific author. I know when you look at the timeline, you see a lot of novels, but he said that he had a lot of trouble actually meeting deadlines, following through on commitments. It's kind of not an inspiration, that's the wrong word, right? But for those of us who procrastinate and don't always meet our own writing deadlines or things like that, a consolation perhaps, right? To find out that somebody who could write this sort of stuff also struggled with getting things done.
I think he liked to say, "I love the sound of deadlines as they rush by."
Yeah. Yeah. Apparently, and I don't know if it's actually true, he had to be locked into a hotel room to get one of the books done, which is kind of remarkable. Are you here for the Hitchhiker's Guide discussion?
Is that a Hitchhiker's Guide?
Yeah. Yeah. You might have to get a chair, though.
They're not letting us
bring chairs. Oh, they are? Seriously?
I think there's like a capacity.
Oh. Well, that's unfortunate.
We've met it.
Is it just going to
suggest whatever you want.
You're talking about?
Okay. That's up to you.
I'll go. I get to get this at home. So.
Okay, yeah.
I'll give up my chair.
All right.
But I mean, other books besides Hitchhikers.
Tonight is Hitchhikers.
What's that?
Tonight
is Hitchhikers.
Yeah, this is a monthly series, so we do
one book at a time.
Yes.
Well, one author at a time. So we're actually doing five books, but all Douglas Adams.
Oh, okay.
You can have a seat here if you want.
I'll skip that.
Oh, okay.
Go back and sit down.
All right. Well, let's continue. So, we've got this timeline. You notice it's not really that long. Unfortunately, he died just 49. Had a heart attack, apparently, not long after he was exercising. So he's one of these people who does the right stuff and still, the bad thing happens to him. His wife actually dies fairly young as well of cancer some years later, leaving their daughter alone. But you can see, so he's born in Cambridge in 52. So he's essentially, a baby boomer. They moved to East London. His parents divorce pretty early. He goes on with his mother. They move into an animal shelter. Not that they were living in the actual shelter itself, but I think above it, which is run by his grandparents. And he begins attending this Brentwood school. And our schools are a bit different here. This is a school that was a prep school, so it was going to get you into better schools, and then you could continue on at Brentwood and do your studies. And Adams is he's already writing some things by that time. He writes for the school paper. He's got an eye for the funny. He's a little bit awkward, but because by the time that he's finishing, I think he's about 6'5". He's 6 foot tall when he's 12. One of his teachers would say, you could always just say, go, instead of go to the tree, everyone go by Adams. And he continues on, he goes to Cambridge, and he starts studying English, and he gets involved in these comedy things. He starts his own sort of skit group. He wants to get into the Footlights, which is a comedy club that a lot of people go through. And he eventually gets elected to that. And he graduates with a degree in English literature, and then he gets discovered by Monty Python's Graham Chapman. I think there are quite a few of these things where Adams thought, well, this is gonna work out now. And it doesn't quite pan out like he expects. His career doesn't take off with the writing as he'd hoped. He ends up getting a little bit depressed, moves in back with his mom, and starts taking a succession of odd jobs that he writes about and talks about at different times, including being a bodyguard for an Arab family, wealthy Arab family, but doing other things too, So that goes on, and he does continue writing, and by 77, he So he's 25 by then, right? He starts writing and performing skits for the radio. And the pilot series of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy gets commissioned by the BBC. So this is a major thing. And you can see that really the rest of his career is following in the wake of the Hitchhiker's Guide. He does have other projects, but that's the thing that, that really places him on the map, you could say. He gets involved with a married woman for a while the second series is airing, and then he gets involved with this woman, Jane Belson, who he'll later marry and have a child with. And he continues writing, but you notice it's not an awful lot. He does do a lot of writing for television. He wrote some Doctor Who stuff, for example, and works in some Hitchhiker's jokes, apparently, into several episodes. But he's not super prolific. This is the billed as the ultimate Hitchhiker's Guide because it's got all the stories in it. This is, you know, five, and it's fairly large print, right? So this is not a ton of writing. You could actually read your way through this, I would say, in a long weekend, because it's fairly breezy style. One thing that he does do that I think is kind of remarkable is he gets involved with all sorts of other media. So, you know, there's the radio, but he also gets involved in the TV series of The Hitchhiker's Guide. He helps produce an early text-based computer game, The Hitchhiker's Guide. Later on, he helps to co-found a tech company that is going to produce another game. And one of the things that he says about this, and this will nicely wrap up the biography part, is this is forward to this. He says that... where is this? He's talking about the fact that the radio series, the book series, the television series, the game, and all of these sorts of things don't actually map onto each other. There's inconsistencies between all of them, which kind of fits his way of working at things. So he talks about the computer game. He says, if this were not all enough, I wrote a computer game for Infocom called The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which bore only fleeting resemblances to anything that had previously gone under the title. He doesn't have a problem with those sort of inconsistencies. And I think that comes out of his view on the universe. So this is a good segue into looking at the world that he created and some of the things that sort of characterize his approach to things. So, you know, this talk series is about universes or narrative worlds. And usually, you know, like we started with somebody like Tolkien, who planned things out meticulously. We call him an architect. They contrast that to somebody like a gardener, like George R. R. Martin, whose world is pretty rich, right? There's a lot of material there. Adams really only reveals bits of the world that he needs to in order to make the plot work, or in order to make a point that he wants to. He just sort of develops it on the fly and builds it out. It's not a coherent universe in a lot of respects, and we'll talk about some of the reasons why it becomes even less and less coherent by the end. And it's not a globally known universe, you could say. So it's not like there is a Hitchhiker's Guide, right? But it's just a guide. It's not a map. It's not a comprehensive study. The entry on Earth is just two words, mostly harmless. Right? So think about the totality of this world that we live in and summing it up with two words. And that's, you know, pared down from whatever, how many thousand words that Ford Prefect had written on Earth. But, you know, a couple thousand words on Earth, right? Not much, right? And that's sort of typical for Adams. The basic aspects of human life and civilizations seem to be more or less the same all over the galaxy that he's got. You know, so there's tax collectors, and hairdressers and people stealing spaceships and rock bands and all the sorts of things, all the same headaches that we have, all the same aggravations. Sometimes, raised to higher levels because technology has allowed that to happen. There's lots of inhabited planets and life forms. There's economic exchange and, wars and civilizations going on. And then, as he says, far out in the uncharted backwaters of the unfashionable end of the western spiral arm of the galaxy lies a small, unregarded yellow sun, our sun, right? Orbiting this at a distance of roughly 92 million miles is an utterly insignificant little green, blue-green planet whose ape-descended life forms are so amazingly primitive, they still think digital watches are a pretty neat idea. That's his sum up at the beginning of us. There's a lot of things that are sort of spread throughout the galaxy that provide, you could say, some local consistency. So there's the guide, right? The guide tells you how to get around in this crazy galaxy. There are certain rules of thumb, like you should always have your towel. There's not a common language, but because they have this babble fish that you can shove in your ear, and it allows it sort of automatically translates. They've got this, essentially the universal translator from things like Star Trek, right? So that deals with that. There's also things like the Sirius Cybernetics Corporation making useless trinkets and robots that don't do what they're supposed to do, and doors that really enjoy opening and talking to you as they open. It seems to be like a big concern spread throughout the entire galaxy. Yeah.
I was just thinking of the influence. The babblefish is what they're calling that little micro device.
Yeah.
I mean, I think most of us have seen it, but it's kind of funny, right? They're actually naming it the babblefish.
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch of things
that are
coming from the Hitchhiker's Guide.
Yeah.
Like that, yeah. I mean, it makes sense. It's a series that really appeals to people. Nowadays it's not really a slur to call somebody a nerd or a geek, right? The way it used to be 20 years ago. But I think this is a series that particularly took off in that milieu, right? But yeah, so that's supposed to, afford us some continuity. And why is this important? Well, if you want to tell a story, it's so much easier. I mean, think again about Tolkien, right? He was a linguist, so it's not such terrible work for him, but coming up with a whole language that the elves speak, and then another language for these people, and another language for these people, and making sure that things were consistent across the board. It's a lot easier just to say, well, there's a babblefish, and now we just write, Ford Prefect was doing this, these other people did this, they're all talking to each other and having no problem understanding each other. There's also, the Vogons play a big role throughout this. They're the ones who blow up the Earth to start with to make a new interstellar traffic. What is it? Express lane. And they by the end of the guide the end of the series, they're actually taking over the Hitchhiker's Guide. They did a sort of hostile takeover. Disguising themselves, and there's all sorts of skullduggery going on, but they're pretty they're consistent across the board too. You can expect them to act like brutal, terrible beings. They're sort of the closest thing to an enemy that you've got in the series. There's two other things that I wanted to bring up about the universe, and then maybe we'll stop and do a little bit of discussion and question and answer. If it's useful. So one of the things that Adam says that I think kind of captures the spirit of this, he says, the history of every major galactic civilization tends to pass through three distinct and recognizable phases: survival, inquiry, and sophistication, otherwise known as the how, why, and where phases. So far, so good. Sounds like an anthropologist or a historian. For instance, the first phase is characterized by the question, how can we eat? The second by the question, why do we eat? And the third, where shall we have lunch? So you're already starting to descend into the comic or the almost the trivial, right? And there's a lot of that going on in here. The other thing that comes up that I did give you this interesting quotation from, religion plays an important role in this. Adams himself is an atheist and describes himself as a, how does he put it, a
radical
atheist. That's right, yeah. Why a radical atheist? So people will quit bothering him about whether he's really serious about the atheist business or not. They say, maybe you're just an agnostic. Have you thought it through? And he says, no, if you, I want to signal that I really mean it. I've thought about it a great deal, that it's an opinion that I hold seriously. And he says, it's funny how many people are genuinely surprised to hear a view expressed so strongly. In England, we seem to have drifted from vague, wishy-washy Anglicanism to vague, wishy-washy agnosticism, both of which I think betoken a desire to have, not to have to think about things too much. That's sort of his big enemy there. He thinks we should think about things, and if we arrive at conclusions that we don't like, maybe, you know, we need to think some more, but we're not going to get out of it by not thinking about it. Now, on the other side, he says, I am fascinated by religion. So he's an atheist. He thinks religion all bunk, but he's fascinated by it. Why? He says, it's had such an incalculably huge effect on human affairs. What is it? What does it represent? Why have we invented it? How does it keep going? What will become of it? I love to keep poking and prodding at it. I've thought about it so much over the years that that fascination is bound to spill over into my writing. And it does, because early on in The Hitchhiker's Guide, he gets rid of God with a philosophical argument. Here's the argument. I refuse to prove that I exist, says God, for proof denies faith, and without faith I am nothing. Oh, says man, but the babblefish is a dead giveaway, isn't it? It proves you exist, and so therefore you don't. QED. Oh, I hadn't thought of that, says God, who promptly vanishes in a puff of logic. Now, there's so much wrong with that on a sort of argumentative level, but it really does work as a piece of comedy, doesn't it? It's sort of like the liar's paradox. Are you guys familiar with this one? I am lying to you right now. Am I lying to you? Because if I am, then I'm telling the truth, right? But if I'm telling the truth, then I'm not lying, which means that in saying that I'm lying to you, I would be lying, and it just sort of generates this loop going back and forth that you can actually model with mathematically with a Möbius strip. The only reason I know that is because I did it back as an undergraduate when I was really interested in those sorts of things. But that's the same sort of thing. A God who realizes that he can't exist by his own rules and so disappears. Adams builds that into the book at the very beginning. And so what you've got is a universe where God is not going to be an explanatory principle, but where all sorts of people do believe in God and gods and act accordingly. Not any of the main characters, of course. They're all pretty, agnostic about things. I suppose you could say that Zaphod is so narcissistic that if there were going to be a deity, he would be worshiping himself. But the others don't really seem to worry too much about it at all. So before we launch into the philosophical themes, any questions about the world building or Adam's biography or things you guys want to say or your own reflections? A lot of you have read at least the first book or perhaps some of the others.
I haven't watched it much yet, but BBC America is doing Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency.
Oh, yeah.
They started doing that around the holidays.
Okay.
And it's a regular series now on BBC America.
That was odd.
With Tobey Maguire,
yeah.
One of the characters.
Okay.
Oh, it's good, but it's very odd. I watched a few of those.
Well, that's Douglas Adams.
Adams is kind of the same across his writings. Even the nonfiction writings are humorous, mm-hmm. right? The same sort of orientation. You see him in interviews too. Like he's very interesting to watch. Speculate about technology, or I've got some stuff here about the internet that we'll talk about perhaps in a while. That's quite interesting. So I imagine that ethos is still still there.
I just remember starting to read them when I was a teenager, and I'm trying to work out the timeline, if they were all printed ahead of time, or if any of them came out.
While you were a teenager?
Those situations where we were eagerly anticipating the next one to come out, and I can't remember now.
Well, yeah, that's a good question. So...
84.
I mean, Mostly Harmless is 92. So that's quite a bit down the line. Not a, I don't think any of us were that young then. Maybe, right?
I'm too young to read at that point.
I was working in a bookshop when that one came out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
What was that like?
I mean, as you might expect, the people who...
Were they mobbing it?
Well, the people who were very, very excited about it were very, very excited about it. And we had to keep reordering. But, I mean, it's like you said, it's a niche... Science fiction fantasy itself is a niche. Adams is his own brand within that, I think. But, you know, he always reminded me a little bit of, is it Tom Robbins, who wrote, Even Cowgirls Get the Blues. There was sort of that same sense of, fandom about it. Where people were very, very excited about the characters and very, very excited about seeing what would happen next. And
I suppose...
Still Life with Woodpecker, I think, was another...
I suppose there were so few people that had managed to, bring those two worlds together, comedy, because he really is a great comedy person, and science fiction. I mean, there is funny, or in fantasy, there were some funny fantasy people, like Fritz Leiber, for example.
But he seems to, kind of really ace snark, you know, and I think that's kind of
absurdity.
The comedy between him and Robbins,
Yeah, he was doing snark before we had the word, I suppose, We can say that. Well, so one of the philosophical themes that I thought we could talk about is what I want to call a fundamentally comic or comedic universe. And, you know, that's what's going on here. It's not some grand tragedy or space opera where, I mean, there is saving the world involved, right? But it's still silly while they're doing it. It's these white robots that are trying to put together a cricket wicket and all that sort of stuff. And I think in the fourth book, but most of it is kind of episodic, moving from this to this to this to this, jumping around. There are some by the end, Arthur Dent gets to know his daughter, who he didn't realize that he had, but why didn't he realize that he had her? Because as one of the last living human beings, he was able to travel all around the universe by giving bits of his DNA. So some of that was actually sperm donation, and apparently there was quite a market in it. And so one of the other remaining humans took that and conceived a daughter who then later finds him and is sort of a typical teenager, just all sorts of trouble and misunderstanding. And nowadays she probably would be a goth, very, very sad or an emo or something like that. And so it's not a universe that there's lots of bad things that happen, but they're almost always arranged in a funny way. And so there's a real contrast to tragedy. Aristotle, when in a book that unfortunately we only have part of, the Poetics, he discusses the difference between comedy and tragedy in a way that a lot of literary theorists later would take up. So I think probably a lot of us got this in high school. Tragedy is about somebody with what? A fatal... flaw, right? And it's very high level people within the society. So think about Greek tragedy, right? Oedipus, he's a king. Agamemnon, he's a king. Clytemnestra, who's going to kill him off, she's a queen. Orestes, son of a king, right? It's always these people who are at the top. Comedy isn't like that. Aristotle says comedy, you don't need high-level characters. That's why we like. That's why we can laugh at them, because they're kind of screw-ups. Greek comedy went through a couple phases. Some of it was actually very, very lowbrow. There were what were called the satyr plays that eventually are going to move into other things. Those are basically slapstick. You know, we don't actually have any of them, unfortunately, but we have bits of them, and we can surmise it. The actual comedies that we have, like Aristophanes, they're pretty funny, and they don't pull any punches. They made fun of actual people living in Athens at the time, targeted them. New comedy was more like our sitcoms, where we have these stock characters, you know, and they get into scrapes and adventures, and by the end of the half hour, everything's wrapped up, you know. And so if we contrast, you know, a tragic universe, like, for example, Star Wars would be a tragic universe, right? This is a completely comedic universe. So what does that mean? One of the things you can get away with in this is not explaining things unless you choose to. And I think that's kind of characteristic of comedy. I'll give you one example from later on in the stories. There's something that's called the total perspective vortex. And it's supposed to be like a torture device. You put somebody in it, and they can see the entire universe and where they fit in with it. And the answer is, there's a minuscule speck. They don't matter at all. Now, one of the main characters, Zaphod Breebox, is such a narcissist that it doesn't really have that effect on him. Everybody else has gone into it. It's totally destroyed their mind because they can see what an insignificant gnat they are. They're not even a gnat. They're a mite on the gnat, or maybe even just a little, you know, bit of fungus on that mite. However we want to put it. They just don't matter at all. Zaphod goes in and sees that the universe really basically revolves around him. So there's a bit of backstory to this, but it's only enough to get the story moving. The guy who designed it was because his wife kept basically denigrating him and saying, you lack perspective. So he said, fine, I'll fix you. I'll show you what perspective is. And he creates a thing, and he has her go in, and she goes insane. And now, you know, he doesn't have that as an issue anymore. This is Adams. He gets to make a very profound suggestion about the importance of human beings in the universe, but he gets to do it in a comedic way. And he does this over and over again. There's a restaurant at the end of the universe. That's the whole title of the second book and where a lot of the stuff happens. And what they manage to do is get to see the end of the universe and then shift things back so that they don't actually have to experience the being torn apart into nothingness. So it can be kind of a cool thing to do. And there's like an MC and a band that plays and people are having drinks and good food and all of that. So, I mean, those of you who've read it, does this make sense to you? This is a universe that is not just comedic, but almost a universe that's supposed to represent comedy. Does that make sense to say it that way, you think? Or is that going too far, perhaps?
I think everything in it is comedic. There's really not much that's ever taken seriously. Mm-hmm. So that would be a fair way to look at it.
Yeah. I mean, the one candidate would be, I think this is either in the third or the fourth book, when Arthur Dent meets the love of his life. Mm-hmm. Her name is Fenchurch, I think. Fenchurch, described as his soulmate. There's all these things going on, and they're happy for a while, and then they take an interstellar holiday, and then she disappears. And Adam said that he deliberately took her out of the picture because she was kind of gumming up the plot. You know, if you make people too happy, you know, have some depth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some pathos, as we say, then it's not so funny anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Because they can be vulnerable.
Yeah, I think that's right. If we're just sort of going along and it's all ha-ha, you know. I mean, you know, there's a I suppose we could call him a person, right? Mervyn, the paranoid android, the robot, he's having a terrible time, according to himself. But we don't actually feel bad for him, do we? Did any of you feel? I mean, he's there to be comedy material for us. According to him, he's been, you know, existing for eons and terribly underutilized, and he actually, you know, heads off the invasion of the entire universe by becoming tapped into the computer of the people who are about to destroy it, and because he's got a lot of processing capability,
mm-hmm.
and so he contaminates the computer with his what would you call it, his pessimism,
mm-hmm.
and the computer destroys itself. So, you know, maybe sometimes it's good to be depressed. Well, another key idea, and this one I'm sure we're going to have a lot of views on, the meaning of life. That comes up in the very first book. The Vogons destroying the Earth is a big problem, not only because the new type of ship has made, bypasses, interstellar bypasses? I don't remember the exact terminology. It's made them no longer useful. They're redundant. But the Earth was a supercomputer. And no, well, it's not that nobody knew. The Vogons didn't know. But the mice who had bought the whole thing and had it going for millions of years, they sure knew. And it had almost reached the answer that it was seeking. It had been programmed for. I think the book says, like, you know, 10 more minutes and it would have reached the answer. So now the Earth, as the story goes on, the Earth is the second supercomputer, because the first supercomputer, Deep Thought, is asked to find the answer to the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything. And as we know, the answer to that is 42, right? And which is a totally unsatisfying answer to get after, you know, thousands of years of waiting for it. But it actually turns out okay for some of the people who have a stake in it. So, I mean, who has a stake in these ultimate questions like that?
Religious
people, yeah, philosophers. There's one other class that would be out of a job if the computer had given the right answer. That he mentions. He's got kind of an animus against them in this. Psychoanalysts. Or psychotherapists, right? Because they, you know, they're supposed to give us some sort of perspective. And, you know, this is a great consolation to them. They can keep on arguing about it. You know, what does 42 mean? But this is a problem. So they recommission it. Deep Thought says all is not lost. I can help design an even better computer. It'll be an entire planet. It's like an organic thing. Every bit of, like, we would be part of the computer. The answer, well, the question to the answer, not the answer to the question, but the question to the answer would be somehow encoded in all of our subconsciouses. Now, it turns out that doesn't work out the way that they want it to, as we find out later on. Because does anyone remember what the question turns out to be that's contained in Arthur Dent's subconscious? It's, what's 6 times 9?
Now, yeah.
What is that? Is that 42? What is it?
54.
54, right?
Yeah.
And so the question and the answer don't actually match up right. Why is it? Well, there's a whole backstory there that we find out about later on in the books, which means that Douglas Adams probably didn't have it at the time. he came up with it later on. So as it turns out, the Earth humans, because they go back in time and they find, you know, these you know, essentially ape men there developing, but this whole shipload of people land on the Earth. And they are, let's see if I can pronounce this right, the Golgafrinchians. They're the second ship, because the people on Golgafrincha came up with this great plan. You know, they told everybody, the world is coming to an end, our sun is going to explode, or, you know, something will happen, we need to get everybody the hell out of here, we're going to put everybody on ships. We're going to do 3 ships. The first ship will be the thinkers, the people who do all the planning, you know, the really important strategic people, right? And the third ship will be the people who do a lot of work, the people who are actually productive. And the second ship will be everybody else. So that will be the people who, you know, do all the tasks that don't really need to be done, but get really into those sorts of things. You know, when you go into any office, how many of you have ever heard of the Peter Principle? Okay, so a few of you. Okay. The Peter Principle was this idea coined by this guy, Peter, that said in any hierarchical organization, any given person will inevitably rise to their level of incompetence. Now, why will they rise to that level? Because so long as they're competent, they'll keep on getting promoted. So you start out in the mailroom, right? You do your mailroom job well, and then you know you get promoted and you're working in the office as a clerk or something. You do that well, now you become a manager. Now, if you don't do that job well, they're not going to fire you. Because if they did, they'd have to admit that they made a mistake in promoting you. Mm-hmm. But they're not going to promote you anymore. And so now you're unproductive. You're not getting any real work done. You're actually getting in the way of people who are getting work done, who have not yet risen to their level. And you're probably a bit neurotic because of this, is what Peter thought. So the best thing to do is actually make sure you don't rise very far. You cut your losses very early on. Well, this second ship is full of those people who have risen to their level of incompetence. And they're the ones who land on Earth, and we're descended from them. We're not descended from the ape people who were developing. And that screwed up the whole computer. And so what does this mean? We'll never get an answer. I mean, it's a fictional question and answer. It's not a fictional question, right? What is the meaning of life, the universe, and everything? We ask this, right? The notion that it would be 42 or that it would be something that, you know, is contained in this book is fictional. And he deprives us even of that. So, you know, it's a little bit of a sleight of hand. And again, notice who has a stake in this. The religions, philosophers, who are like a guild, you know, in this ancient time and get to argue with each other, and the psychoanalysts, who he says are, you know, basically like parasites. Does it make sense to go about looking for the meaning of life in this sort of way? If you're really into science, technology, maybe it does make sense to give it to a computer to think about. We have some pretty powerful computers. Should we do something like that?
I think people would be terrified of potential answers. I mean, it's the idea of having the capacity of doing that is very exciting, but the idea of actually getting an answer that's definitive is as sort of loathsome as the concept of going into that torture chamber where you see your... Oh, the total perspective. Yeah, yeah. Can I ask a question about something? Yeah. So you may have discussed this when I was out of the room, but was there a comparison at all, or were there literary scholars who wrote about the connections between Swift and Adams?
Oh, I don't know.
Because I keep thinking of
that's
Swift
a,
as
that's
you're mentioning.
That's interesting.
I mean, maybe I'm off, but I haven't read everything, but I.
You know that actually would be, you could make comparisons.
There's some interesting parallels there.
Yeah, the over the top. Yeah,
the over the topness, the sort of satire, but also the preoccupation with what religious figures are telling us.
You know who else would? I mean, people have compared Swift to this person. Would be the first science fiction author, Lucian Samosata. He's a Syrian guy who goes to, Greece and learns really good Attic Greek. He's a satirist. And he writes this true history, which he promises is true only in the sense that none of it is true whatsoever. And they go to the moon and fight, space battles and sail on a sea of milk and all sorts of crazy stuff happens, he also goes into a whale. The whole ship gets swallowed by a whale. I think they start a fire in the whale's belly and whale spits them out. And it's basically two scrolls of this sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Only not in a galaxy, more just in the solar system. But yeah, I suppose you could probably draw a lot of parallels. I mean, you know, Adam's apprenticed in the galleys, you could say, of comedy. You know, he got to find out what would work, and he built it. He sort of condensed it into this, I think.
Was he satirizing in there, like something like Swift or Carroll or something, or was he just comedic?
He's comedic, but I mean, Swift is satirizing all sorts of people. Adams is satirizing all sorts of people too. I can't remember exactly what the reference is, but there's a dig at Reagan in there. There's digs at Thatcher. Mm-hmm. I think one of the robots was a Reagan.
Didn't you go over for skewing establishments more over than actual people? I mean, there were certain specific things, but for the most part, he went for the big organizations, I thought.
Yeah, I mean, and probably a lot of that was based on, you know, actual... I mean, he dealt with the BBC, which could not have been fun. You know, I mean, that's a big bureaucratic organization, and they're supposed to be in charge of comedy. Right? So...
I keep thinking too of another influence, and I might just be inventing this, but it seems like it's Matt Groening who invented Futurama, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It seems like he was influenced by Adams, and just some of the things that he's explored in the episodes, and you know the ways in which some of the characters tend to make maybe not direct reference to, but almost kind of like an homage to Adams and the ways in which Bender, for example, and some of the other characters.
Yeah, I could see that.
Don't you think a little bit?
Yeah.
There's just been some things that kind of get slipped in. It's kind of like what you were saying about the, you know, that being geeky and nerdy is no longer a bad thing. It's become sort of like a badge amongst like those of us who claim it. So when you see things influencing other things, it's just...
Yeah, I mean, there's like a whole like sort of code out there, you know. I mean, you can tell people don't forget your towel, and you know, if they catch on,
right?
That's true. Yeah.
Meme. I mean, and most people don't even know what it's referencing.
Yeah.
That are using it, you know. So.
Yeah,
but I think you bring up a good point about Futurama, because there are some bits of comedy that are very much like Adams. An early episode, one of the characters is talking on the telephone, and he goes, "Oh, I've heard some horrible news about my colleague. He was torn to shreds by these monsters. How's his wife taking the news?" "To shreds, you say?" "So she was with him."
That's true. Well, they have the smelloscope too. You know, they smell things at a distance, and yeah. I mean, another thing that Futurama does is screw around with time and history.
Yeah.
The way that Adams has the series doing later on, which is one of the themes that we'll get to.
And Adams, I think, he died before Futurama even was broadcast, so, or within...
2002. Well, 2001, yeah.
I think it premiered in 99 into 2000 or early
2000.
I think the 90s,
yeah. Yeah. You know, he was somebody who really stayed on top of technological innovation, too.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can see that developing as the books go on. There's more analogies drawn to current technology.
I just wonder if he would have felt about Futurama the way that Terry Pratchett felt about Shrek. I don't think that they copied me, but I think that they had a lot of influence from me, kind of thing.
Yeah, I suppose.
Something you never know.
Well, I think that shows up in Doctor Who, too, with the reboot of Doctor Who. There are bits and pieces that clearly reference some of what Adams wrote.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he had built into some of the earlier Doctor Whos in the 80s a few Hitchhiker jokes.
Mm-hmm.
And so that would make sense. Yeah.
When Doctor Who came back, I can't remember which episode, but it wasn't several episodes in, the new run.
Yeah.
They did a gala ball at the end of the universe.
Oh.
To watch the universe end. And there
that would be very much like
the second episode. And they had the last surviving human was just a piece of skin stretched on a stretcher.
Oh, I remember that. It was horrible.
But it was hilarious.
Yeah.
But it was also funny.
She would just shout at people, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. That was, yeah, that was really gross. Well, you know, actually, so that's a good segue into one of these other philosophical themes, which is the Hitchhiker's Guide as a book. And there's, you know, there's a long history of fiction authors making up books that don't exist. and including him. So, you know, one of the people we'll talk about later on, I think in August, is H.P. Lovecraft, horror writer, right? And he makes up a whole bunch of books like the Necronomicon or the Pnotic Manuscripts or stuff like that that don't exist. They never did exist. Somebody else who's really good at that is somebody who we're going to look at the very end of the year, Jorge Luis Borges, where he has stories where a book doesn't exist, but yet it somehow manages to contaminate the whole universe in a way, and turn the universe essentially into like a fiction story. He's breaking down the walls. Now with this, we have, so let's just take this, right? So this is called The Ultimate Hitchhiker's Guide because it contains all five of the volumes and also one of the spin-off stories. So you can call this the Hitchhiker's Guide, right? And some of you have copies also of the first book, right? The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And then there is the radio series and the TV series, and we can say, okay, well, that's all more or less the same thing. But not only do we have the story itself, the Hitchhiker's Guide is an artifact within the story, and it plays a central role within it. So where is the real Hitchhiker's Guide? It's not this. This is just sort of a dim reflection of it. A little bit about some of the people who encounter the fictional Hitchhiker's Guide, which exists in that narrative universe, and which is in the process of being continually compiled and updated and involves a like galaxy-wide organization, which is even, you know, able to be taken over by a rival organization in the fourth or fifth book. So which is the real guide? You know, there's this concept. I don't know if the person who came up with it was named MacGuffin or, but are you guys familiar with this term of MacGuffin? Mm-hmm. It's like some sort of object that you, it gets referred to, and everybody's seeking after, but you never actually get to see in a story.
I think Maltese Falcon was the example, right?
Yeah. Although, don't we do... We do get to see it, right?
We do.
Yeah.
For most of the story. Yeah. It's kind of like irrelevant what it actually is.
Yeah. So is the guide in the story a MacGuffin? We get little bits of it, because Adams will give us, like, entries. He'll say, and then Ford Prefect looked up the entry to this or that, you know. Arthur Dent, you know, spent hours reading the entries on these things. But we don't get the whole guide. I mean, it would be impossible. It's gigantic, right? It's something that we could actually have on a phone, perhaps. Maybe not the 16 gig, but maybe the 32 gig phone, right? Or, you know, I mean, I just think about it, like, what this is like compared to what computers were 20 years ago, right? And what they're going to be like in some galaxy, you know, distant in time from us. Maybe you could have something that you just carry around. It would be this guide that would tell you about everything. So, which is the real guide? What we've got here is an imaginary book that can take on an existence, and you might even say a life, of its own, because of the way Adam structures his narrative universe. And it is a MacGuffin. It's not just something that people use, it's something that becomes something that people desire and fight over. There's a hostile takeover of the guide by these slugs that turn out to be the Vogons, because they want the guide so they can shut it down because it's been interfering with their stuff. And then they come out with a second guide, a better guide, that is a essentially a robot. What else can we say about the guide itself? Well, you mentioned the "Don't Panic," you know, printed across the front. We don't have that on this one, unfortunately, but it was kind of cool. This notion of you need a towel, it's actually decent advice, I think. And it spawned Towel Day, you know, to celebrate this. And it spawned people talking about carrying a towel. And there's all sorts of, you were talking about, you know, Futurama being influenced by it or Doctor Who being influenced by it. You've got something that can contaminate other bits of our reality, so to speak. I mean, maybe contaminate's not a good word.
Alter it.
Yeah. Get its hooks into it in
infect.
Some way.
Okay.
Impact. Yeah, that works.
Infected.
No, contaminate's not a bad word.
No, why not?
Because it's a germ of an idea that gets picked up someplace else and then gets picked up someplace else.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sort of like somebody who Adams liked quite a bit was Dawkins. And he was very influenced by, you know, the selfish gene. Dawkins is one of these people who coined the idea of memes as being these bits of information that somehow replicate themselves, sort of like viruses do, you know. Maybe the Hitchhiker's Guide is not an meme, but a sort of meta meme, a meme that incorporates lots of other memes. I don't think we're actually at a risk of, like in Borges' story, Tlan Ukbar Orbis Tertius, of one book actually turning the rest of the world into fiction. That's not a worry with this. But there's something weird going on with it, right? In the way that it works. So what do we make of this? I don't actually have an answer.
Well, I think when you brought up earlier that he may have even used snark before we had a term, this might just be his attitudes.
Interesting.
Put forward. Because I was trying to find the quote, so I wouldn't misquote it, but one of the favorite bits, I mean, there's so many favorite bits out of all those books, but when you meet one of the few truly immortal creatures in the universe, Wildbagger the Infinitely Prolonged.
Yeah.
And he decided to take his immortality and use it to, let's see if I can remember how it's phrased. He decided he was going to insult everybody in the universe, individually, personally, and this is the bit he really gritted his teeth over, in alphabetical order.
Yeah. There's also the thing, too, with the guy who's actually running the universe, or running the galaxy, at least. Because, you know, Zaffa... He's the president for a while at the start, although he commits crimes and that's it for that. But he's only president because that's supposed to distract from who's actually running the show. And there's this whole like plot of finding who actually is in charge of things, and you'd expect to be like going further and further or deeper and deeper. And it turns out to be a guy in a shack with a cat who doesn't believe the rest of the universe exists, or he's not sure about it, and he doesn't want to be bothered with anything. And you're like, well, how in the hell can that be running the universe? Never explained, just left there, and then that's it for the story, So there's quite a few things along those lines. And so that brings me to the last of the themes that I had picked out. And I call this mucking up the time stream. It doesn't happen early on, but after a while in the stories, I guess you could say you've got a hint of this at the restaurant to the end of the universe, right?
Yeah.
Because they're able to go to when everything breaks down, the end of time, and then somehow pull things back and not die, not be destroyed by it. But you've got travel in space, and eventually they come up with these drives that can overcome the problem of light speed, right? Then once they discover time travel, what happens? So we usually think about things like, well, you know, should I go back and kill baby Hitler, right? I always think that's stupid, right? Why would you kill baby Hitler and impose this moral dilemma on yourself? Just find, you know, going down the bad path, Hitler, and kill him if that's what your game is, because then you won't have all the qualms that you have, right? But who knows what things would have turned out if that had happened. Well, as it turns out, you can't really make major changes. History will find ways of, you know, getting things back on track. It won't always be completely recognizable, but, you know, you can do that. But the problem is, once you introduce time travel and people start to think about its implications, now they start going back into past and monkeying around with things, and you can never be sure, once time travel's been introduced, whether the past that you think is the past is the original past or not. And so they found this campaign for real time, totally, you know, quixotic adventure, right? Tilting at windmills, because by the time that you've actually realized there's a problem, it's so much of a problem, you can't set things right. So not only has, you know, not only do you have a whole complex, crazy universe that has some local consistency, like, you know, the guide says that it may be inaccurate, but at least it's definitively inaccurate, you know, but that's something. Now, the guide might have to be, like, updated because somebody went back and monkeyed around with history and changed things. And so by the time that you get to the end of the fifth book, it's unclear about what originally happened. There's all these alternate timelines. In some of them, the Earth wasn't destroyed. You know, one of the main characters, Trillian, she shows up later on as a different Trillian, who's called Trisha Marie McMillan. That was her original name. She was a mathematician and astrophysicist. She meets Zaphod at a party where he's, you know, he's got two heads, so he's got it covered by a birdcage to pretend he's got a parrot on his shoulder or something like that. And in one timeline, she goes back for her bag, and he takes off, and that's it. And she goes on and becomes a reporter on Earth and all that, and there's like a whole interesting story there about that. In the other, she doesn't go back for her bag, and she goes off gallivanting around the galaxy. And she also becomes a reporter, just with the, you know, the sub-ether news. That's the one who actually has Arthur Dent's child, who, you know, pops out at a certain point and interrupts his life as a sandwich maker, because he's finally found some peace and contentment making sandwiches on this particular world, and really she manages to mess up his world. But those sorts of things are possible because people have muddied up the timeline. Pretty soon you can't be sure of anything. And there's no way to set it right. Maybe that's a metaphor for our universe. You know? Of the present, I don't know.
Or his universe.
His universe? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, his universe is our universe, isn't it? Don't we all exist in the same universe or not? That's a good question.
I don't know. I think it seems to me that he is, you know, by turning everything into a joke, he's taking and, you know, he's hiding behind that. You know, he's not really, you know, I think the fact that he removed one meaningful character from the book, to me, that suggests that he's avoiding anything more serious, and he's just hiding. He's putting up a facade, and it's not providing any answers, really. You know, he's setting up all these questions that makes, you know, we're discussing deep, you know, important questions, and he's not giving answers, you know.
Or the answers that he's giving are just kind of jokes,
right?
Yeah, you wonder whether the comedy is an end in itself or whether, like you're saying, it's there's something deeper that's being covered over, you know. I mean, either way, you would be missing out something, right? If comedy is all you got, and you're just doing it for its own sake, you miss that whole other side of life. There's sometimes we call tragedy or depth or whatever, you know, meaningfulness.
I also like the, I forget which of the books, that something strange happens and one of the characters describes it as an SEP. What's that? Somebody else's problem.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And you can only see it if you look at it out of
yeah.
the corner of your eye. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, he has a lot of very insightful ideas in these books.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe if we want to use that as an analogy, if there's anything meaningful, maybe we only see it out of the corner of our eyes. You know, we're stuck looking at the comedy part, and maybe there is something deeper over on the side.
I know I've used that phrase myself in life. Oh, that's definitely an SCP.
Yeah.
Somebody else's problem.
I like the slightly different framework, the somebody else's circus, somebody else's monkeys.
Oh yeah, not my circus, not my monkeys.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which turns out to be very useful to tell yourself. Gets you out of a lot of headaches.
And I think that the writing's also, and the humor is also very British. Very, there's a dryness to it too, because there's another sequence where Arthur and Ford just appear in the middle of either a rugby or a cricket match.
Yeah, cricket. Yeah.
And it's from the commentator's point of view, and they're like, oh, these two strange people have just appeared on the field, and now there's a sofa. And they're trying to call the game, which is still going on, while Ford and Arthur and the sofa have appeared on. And then the sofa just disappears, and one of the commentators goes, oh, and the sofa's gone. That's one mystery less.
This is like Monty Python.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It is.
I was just thinking that.
Yeah, it's not just that it's British, because there's a lot of different kinds of British comedy, but it is that same sort of thing. You mentioned absurdism. That sense of the anything could lead to anything could lead to anything. I suppose if we wanted to pin it on somebody ostensibly British, we could say that it's sort of, you know, it's sort of like a literary equivalent of David Hume's philosophy, where really anything could happen, you know, and there is no cause and effect. It's just that we've gotten used to things working in a certain way. So, you know, like if I drop something like this, you know, it could be we could imagine that I drop it and instead of doing that, it just floats in the air. It never does happen, but that could happen. Or this could turn into liquid or whatever. You know, if we can imagine it, that means that it's not necessary, this relation that we assume of cause and effect. Now, Hume, you know, thinks that you can't really think like that very long. He actually, in one of his books, says, you know, you sit in your study and think these thoughts to yourself, and then, you know, the answer to that is go play some billiards, you know, with your friends. But a lot of other people did kind of, you know, take off along those lines. It scared the hell out of some other philosophers, like Immanuel Kant. You know, he's talking about Hume shaking him from his dogmatic slumber, and he has got to come up with how causality could, in fact, work. And his answer to how it worked actually turned out to be worse than the predicament that he was placed in from some people's points of view. So I guess, you know, you could say you could find a pedigree for that. Although, I mean, you could say the same thing about what they call picaresque novels, where just things happen one after another, and who knows why the hell they happen that way. Denis Diderot, this Enlightenment philosopher, wrote a great book like that called Jacques, the Fatalist and His Master. And it's sort of almost like prefiguring Waiting for Godot. They have adventures, lots of funny stuff happens along the way. Is there any point to it in the end? Not really. Could it have happened differently? Sure. And they have all these great, you know, sort of philosophizing moments about the nature of cause and effect and why Jacques is the kind of halfway bad guy that he is, and that sort of stuff, but it never actually amounts to anything. And, you know, you wonder, well, what the hell was Diderot doing when he was writing that? I mean, this is a guy who actually was devoted to, you know, this massive sort of intellectual and political cause, and on the side he's writing things like Jacques the Fatalist, you know. Other things he wrote clearly had a kind of political motive to them. He writes a book attacking religion that, you know, it's about nuns, and they're doing all these terrible things in the nunnery, and so, you know, clearly, what should we do? Get rid of the institution. Nothing like that in Jacques the Fatalist. And I suppose so you could say that's perhaps a predecessor of Adams, you know? You probably find a lot of Swift, you mentioned, you know?
He's just a very funny writer, that's all I know.
Yeah. I mean, we certainly can enjoy him without going into deep thoughts, I suppose, too, right? Maybe that's, unless anybody else has something that they want to bring up, maybe that's a good place to end sort of the thing about comedy, is to say we can just enjoy it for its own sake without feeling like we have to come up with some great pretext, even if it is about big questions and that sort of stuff. What do you think?
Sometimes it's just funny.
Yeah, sometimes you don't have to have a
You don't
deep
have to
name.
Analyze it. It's just
yeah.
plain
it's just
pleasure.
Funny.
Or funnier.
I think that's the difference between absurdity that's focused on comedy and absurdity that's not. I mean, you think of something like The Sandbox, or like the theater that focused on the absurd, tended to focus on really terrible moral dilemmas and things
yeah.
that happen and the horrible ways in which we treat one another. But if you focus the absurdity on sort of like that Monty Python thematic or
yeah.
something like Adams, it frees you to have wild and crazy ideas, and they don't have to be resolved, and they don't have to have import or this grand significance, because you can also, at the end of the day, say, like, with Monty Python, you know, it's just two guys, like, putting coconuts together, right?
Or, or the Spanish Inquisition that nobody expects.
Right, and that's okay,
yeah.
you know? The Brian that's not the Christ. I mean, you can have all of these things, and it causes you to think, maybe more deeply about these meanings.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
yeah.
there's sort of like a Mel Brooksiness to it, too, and, you know, there's just people who play with that in a thoughtful, intelligent, but also very irreverent way,
yeah.
I think can provoke us to do more mm-hmm. analytical inquiry in a way that feels less frightening, because it doesn't feel like the whole weight of, like, the relationship between these two people is on our shoulders to resolve and figure out. So, you know, it can be fun, but it doesn't have to be devoid of meaning.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, when things are couched in comedy, they're often more gentle
yeah.
and more accessible,
mm-hmm.
and the fear element doesn't arise because it's softened by that.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that, the gentleness of it.
Yeah.
It feels less... You know,
that would apply, I think that works for this. I don't know that would apply to comedy across the board. Like, I think of a show that I very much enjoy, Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
No.
They're not making, I mean, they're talking about, like, big social topics, and they're very, very crass, right?
But that's, yeah, and that's playing more with convention and,
yeah.
like, making you deliberately uncomfortable in the way that I think, like, Brecht or some of the other, like, the theater element of that
okay.
discomfort is more where I would put Always Sunny.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that's what made me think of Swift, too. Like,
Littlefoot,
yeah, you know,
kinda,
I
yeah.
mean, it's like, oh, wow, that's something, you know? But you can also just see little people and have some fun with that and, you know, read it for what it is. So.
That's true, yeah.
In many ways more complex.
Okay. Well, does anyone else have anything they want to say or ask about, or should we bring it to a close?
What nonfiction did you write?
Oh, not too much. I mean, there's this Last Chance to See. There was something else in here as well.
You mentioned it was a lot smaller. Is it some of the works on this list are nonfiction?
A few, yeah. I mean, he didn't really write that much when it comes down to it.
Right. The meaning of lip was more like a dictionary of funny,
that's
non,
right, yeah.
non-real words, but there's no narrative to it.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I suppose a guide to the guide would... Is a is a literary criticism, right? Or literary explanation is nonfiction, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose that would be nonfiction as well, but it's nonfiction about fiction, right?
And nonfiction about your own fiction.
It's your own fiction.
That's a little meta. Like,
yeah, it's hard to classify.
Kind of,
it's a good thing to end on, I think. Nice job.